Hello everybody, welcome to NEET Crash Course Biology. So now we will be discussing the synopsis of chapter Ecosystem. So what exactly does ecosystem mean? Ecosystem means it is a self-regulated and a self-sustaining structural and functional unit of nature. This is a very important thing to remember. It is the structural and functional unit of nature, and you have already learned that in an ecosystem, there is active interaction between the living organisms as well as the physical environment around them. So there is active interaction taking place between biotic and abiotic components. The area in an ecosystem, a particular area in an ecosystem where the environmental conditions are rather uniform, is referred to as the biotope. And you all are aware that ecosystem as a term was introduced by Tansley in the year 1935. So what are the two components? Just now I told you that it is nothing but a dynamic system where there is constant interaction between two components. So the living component of the ecosystem is called biotic, and the non-living component of the ecosystem is referred to as abiotic. What are the biotic components? Now, first we have the producers. You all know that autotrophs are those organisms which can convert the radiant energy in the sunlight into chemical energy in the form of organic substances. So they have the machinery, they have the required apparatus in order to capture the energy from the sunlight and convert it in the storage form. And this storage form is mostly in the form of organic compounds. So such animals which utilize the solar energy and can synthesize organic compounds are referred to as producers. And there are organisms which cannot make their own food, which depend on producers in order to obtain their nourishment. So these are referred to as consumers or heterotrophs. They ingest their food, and they are also referred to as phagotrophs. Finally, we have decomposers. Decomposers are also called as reducers because they mostly feed on dead and decaying organic remains of the body. And since they feed on dead and decaying remains, which are referred to as the detritus, some of them are also referred to as detritivores. And some of these decomposers, which include microorganisms, may also be parasites. Now, if you think about the detritivores or the scavengers are the animals or are basically the organisms which feed on the dead remains of other organisms, which are referred to as the detritus. So these detritivores include termites and carrion beetles, for example. So remember, the decomposers may be detritivores or they may be parasitic in nature. Some of the abiotic components, we have also discussed this in the chapter Organisms and Population. You have temperature, you have light, wind, humidity, precipitation or rainfall, and then water, which is one of the most important aspects, topography of the landscape, and then you have the dissolved gases, and then pH of the soil, which is very, very important in the distribution of vegetation. Then you have soil texture and how much minerals does the soil contain, that is the mineral elements present in the soil or the water for that matter. So now moving on to a concept called as productivity. Before we talk about productivity, we need to talk about production. In production, we are focusing on primary production. It can be defined as the amount of organic matter. Since we are talking about photosynthesis here, you all learned that during photosynthesis, organic substances are produced, and that is what is the biomass. So the amount of biomass or the organic substance that is produced per unit area. So this should be in the power. So it is gram per meter square or kilocalorie per meter square. It can be expressed either in terms of gram, in terms of weight, or in terms of calories. So basically, remember the amount of organic matter produced per unit area. If you attach the rate, if you attach the time to this, then it becomes primary productivity. See, for primary productivity, the definition is the same, but we stopped at unit area for primary production. Now you're taking into account unit time as well, and then the overall amount of organic matter that is produced per unit area per unit time is referred to as gross primary productivity. But if a plant produces a lot of organic matter, it will not simply store all of it. Much of it is used for its own respiratory processes, for its own life processes. So you have to subtract the respiratory losses from the gross primary productivity, then the remaining organic matter which is available to the next trophic level, which is available for consumption to the consumers, is referred to as the net primary productivity. So please remember, the net primary productivity is what is available, the energy which is stored in the biomass, which is available for the next trophic level. We already discussed that heterotrophs which ingest the food are occupying the next trophic level to the producers. They are referred to as consumers. So if you attach the criteria of time to primary production, then it becomes primary productivity. So here it's very important for you to mention, it is not only per unit area, the amount of biomass or organic matter that is produced per unit area, per unit time, is called as primary productivity. When we talk about producers, we are obviously going to talk about producers here, because productivity involves the process of photosynthesis. There are two aspects. One is called gross primary productivity. If you subtract respiratory losses from gross primary productivity, then you get net primary productivity, which is available to the next trophic level. Now, a consumer feeds upon the producer, and the consumer uses up much of its energy for its own life processes, for digestion, for excretion. It assimilates it for its own life processes. However, the consumer also stores the organic matter in the form of flesh. The amount of biomass or organic matter that is stored by the consumer in the form of flesh per unit area, per unit time, is referred to as secondary productivity. In other words, the rate of production of organic matter, not in producers but in the terms of consumers. So if you are eating the plant, you are getting much of the energy by the stored organic matter that is present in the plant. Not all of it will you store it in the form of flesh in your body, or in terms of in the form of fat in your body. Some of it is used up in your energy, that is for the feeding process, for digestion, for excretion, and for all the life processes that are happening. Only a fraction of it you store it as a reserve food material. That fraction that you store, or the amount of biomass that you store per unit area, per unit time of consumers, is referred to as secondary productivity. What is net primary productivity? Some of the statistics here. The annual overall throughout the year, the net primary productivity of the entire biosphere is a massive 170 billion tons of organic matter. Please remember, productivity is only in terms of organic matter, because it is a byproduct of, it is the major product of photosynthesis, isn't it? And then, even though oceans occupy much of the area on this planet, they only contribute about 55 billion tons of primary net annual primary productivity in comparison to that of land. Some of the factors that affect primary productivity is light, temperature, water, nutrients, and most importantly, the photosynthetic capacity or photosynthetic efficiency of producers, because it all boils down to photosynthesis, photosynthetic pigments, ability to harness the radiant solar energy, and the ability to synthesize starch, which is nothing but the organic substance. Then, moving on to decomposition, we already discussed that decomposition is a degradation process carried out by microorganisms called decomposers. But before that, we have organic remains which fall on the forest floor, which may be dead plant parts, which may be flowers and fruits and twigs and carcasses of animals or fecal matter. This is referred to as the detritus. There are two types of detritus which fall on the forest floor. Some of them which are exposed on the ground, they are called above ground detritus, and some of them which remain below the ground, they are called below ground detritus. So if you have a detritus based on the environmental condition and based on various processes which is carried out by decomposers or detritus feeders like fragmentation, for example, fragmentation is carried out by a detritus feeder like earthworm, which breaks down the larger substances into smaller substances. So basically it reduces the size of the detritus, isn't it? So it feeds upon the detritus and it breaks down the larger particles into smaller particles by a process called fragmentation. And then much of the water soluble minerals that are present in the detritus will be washed away by the water into the deeper parts of the soil, and it is made unavailable to the plants. That is referred to as leaching. And finally, the decomposers break down the complex organic substances present in the detritus into simpler inorganic substances, and that is referred to as catabolism. Ultimately, you have a brown amorphous powdery substance that is obtained, which is degraded, which is also a colloidal substance, which is a storehouse because of lot of inorganic nutrients, it is called the humus. And finally, when the humus slowly undergoes degradation, it releases all the minerals, that is carbon dioxide, water and nutrients, which is called as mineralization. All this is happening simultaneously and all this is being carried out by detritus feeders like earthworm. Like I said, earthworm is involved only in fragmentation. And then you have lot of microbes which carry out the process of leaching, catabolism, humification and mineralization. Some of the factors that affect decomposition are temperature, moisture, pH, chemical composition and aerobiosis. Very important, decomposers are aerobic bacteria. They require oxygen to break down the complex organic substances into simpler inorganic substances. Moving on to trophic level, every organism, every species in a food chain occupies a particular level or occupies a particular stage, which is referred to as a trophic level based upon its source of nutrition or based upon from whom it derives nutrition, how it derives nutrition. Does it derive nutrition by harnessing the energy from the sunlight, or does it derive nutrition by feeding on another organism? Accordingly, in the trophic level, we have the primary producers. We already discussed now, they are the ones which capture the solar energy. Then those which feed on the primary producers or they obtain nourishment from the primary producers are called primary consumers or herbivores. And those that feed on the primary consumers are called secondary consumers or carnivores. And those which are at the topmost part of the food chain, which occupy the top position, are the tertiary consumers or the top carnivores. So like I said, they belong to a particular trophic level depending upon what resource they use, depending upon what they feed on. And basically you have to remember, within the trophic level, there is something referred to as a guild. Within each trophic level, if you say, there are a group of organisms or a group of species which have similar resource base. Like for example, you have all the birds feeding on nectar. They are usually dependent upon the same resource, which is the nectar from the flower. All the animals which graze, they are basically dependent upon the same resource, which is the grassland or the grasses, isn't it, to graze on. So within a trophic level, the species which depend upon a common resource base, they are referred to as a guild. And basically in a food chain, you have to remember, the trophic level represents a functional level and it is always occupied by many, many species. It is not that a particular trophic level has only one particular species. It is many, a mixture of different species occupying a particular trophic level. Now moving on to marine ecosystems, let us focus mostly on marine ecosystems. Now we are aware that marine ecosystems cover a whopping 71% of the Earth's surface, but they contain approximately 97% of planet's water. They include a varied diversity of organisms like algae. All these are microscopic protists like dinoflagellates, corals or coelenterates, mollusks like cephalopods and echinoderms, and fishes like sharks. And fishes that are caught in the marine ecosystem are the biggest source of commercial food. You know how pisciculture is being carried out, at what rate today. Then we have, they generate 32%, or they constitute 32% of the world's net primary production, all the organisms or the autotrophs which are present in the marine ecosystem. And they basically contain, the marine ecosystem or the seawater mostly contains dissolved material in them. Approximately 85% of the dissolved material is sodium and chlorine, that is salt, and that's why seawater is salty to taste. And actual salinity varies among different types of marine ecosystems, but the basic salt is sodium and chlorine. Structure is, if you think about the structure of oceans, you have ocean basin, which you can think of like an inverted hat or like a wash basin. Initially, you all have visited the beaches or the coastal areas. Initially, the slope, there is a gradual sloping that begins, and there's something which usually slopes gradually. There is no steepness to it, and this is referred to as the continental shelf. As you keep walking into the beach, you must have seen it gets deeper and deeper and deeper. There is no immediate depth over there, but it is a gradual deepness that follows, and that is referred to as the continental shelf. The continental shelf may extend to a depth of about 8 to 200 meters, and there is a point which is called as the continental edge, where suddenly the slope becomes deeper, and that particular region where it suddenly becomes deeper near the coastal region is referred to as continental slope. And then the continental slope, eventually it becomes flattened to form the horizontal ocean floor, that is the floor of the ocean, which may extend to about, that is, which may be about 6 to 10 kilometers in depth. And how do we classify the different regions of the ocean depending upon how much light penetrates? The first zone is referred to as the photic or the euphotic zone, which is the upper lit, well-lit zone by light that is up to about 200 meters. And then we have the zone where there is very little light, which is not sufficient for the process of photosynthesis. It extends somewhere between 200 to 2000 or 200 to 4000 meters. And then it comes the abyssal zone, where there is absolutely no light and there is perpetual darkness over there. It extends beyond 2000 or 4000 meters, where photosynthesis cannot happen at all. So you can see here, this slopy region is nothing but the continental shelf, and this is the point where the continental shelf starts taking a dip, and this is referred to as the continental slope. And this flattened zone is the ocean floor that you can see. And then you can see how the superficial zone of the ocean, which receives sufficient light, is called the photic zone, about 200 to about up to about 200 meters. And then you have a photic zone from about 4000 meters up to about 4000 meters. And then beyond that, you have the up to about 6 to 10 kilometers, you have the abyssal zone, where there's absolutely no light whatsoever. Then we have the littoral zone. It comprises of the seafloor from the shore to the edge of the continental shelf. We saw the point where the continental shelf starts taking a steep dive inside. There is a steep depth following, that is referred to as the continental edge, from the region of the seashore to the region of this point where the depth becomes very, very prominent or very, very steep, is called the littoral zone. And then along the seafloor, you can see the benthic zone, and then the open seawater is called as the pelagic zone, where there's a lot of light. Plankton, you all know, are microscopic organisms, and these planktons are those which basically do not have any locomotory organs. They usually are carried by the mercy of water currents. They're basically moving passively in water. They do not basically have any kind of locomotory structures. There are two types of plankton. One is called phytoplankton and one is called zooplankton. Phytoplankton is for basically microscopic plants, and zooplankton are basically microscopic animals. If there is an animal that has a locomotory structure of its own and that can swim very actively, it is called as nekton. So basically, remember, those animals which are swimming around in the seawater with active locomotory structures, like you can think of all the big fish and the small fish and the whales and the dolphins and the jellyfish and the cuttlefish and the turtles, are all referred to as the nekton. Then you have those which are usually restricted to the bottom or restricted to the floor of the sea, the horizontal floor of the sea. They're referred to as the bottom dwellers or the benthos. You have crabs and starfishes and sponges and corals, which are sedentary and fixed to the bottom of the seafloor. Then you have the marine biome types. There are open seas, there are coastal regions, and there are estuaries. Estuaries are nothing but the mouth of the river, where the river joins the sea, and they are considered to be very, very rich in biodiversity, because the water there is enriched with nutrients, which is brought down by rivers which flow and enter the seas, which join the seas. If you think about open seas, we all saw that there is continental shelf which may extend to a depth of about 200 meters. And this open sea is something which is beyond the continental shelf, where you see the continental edge, where there is a drastic slope, which is called the continental slope. From there on, the open sea water is, again, we saw that it is divided into the photic zone up to a depth of about 200 meters. To a depth of about 4000 meters is about aphotic zone, and beyond that is abyssal zone, where there's perpetual darkness. Then you have the coastal regions. In the coastal regions, you have the continental shelf. The productivity of the coastal biome is 2000 to 6000 kilocalorie. Remember, primary productivity is expressed in terms of per unit area, per unit time. So remember the productivity of the coastal biomes, because it is mostly well lit with sunlight. The most productive and the most biodiverse parts of the coastal region are the coral reefs, because near coral reefs, you can see sufficient sunlight, and most of the seas where you see a lot of coral reefs are mostly shallow waters. They're not deeper seas. Okay. Then you have the coastal regions occupy less than 0.1% of the world's ocean surface, and yet they provide home for about 25% of marine species. So this gives you an idea about the marine coastal regions. Moving on to the estuary, we had discussed that the estuary is something which is very, very rich in biodiversity. It is considered to be the mouth of the river. It has neither too salty nor sweet water. It is referred to as the brackish water. It is the region where one or more rivers or stream opens into the sea, flows into the sea, and the waters are very fertile because the river, while it is flowing down, is carrying with it lot of minerals and lot of oxygen, and carbon dioxide and light is also available in plenty because the water is flowing continuously, and this carbon dioxide is required for the autotrophs in order to fix the solar energy to prepare organic matter through productivity. That's why the productivity is quite high over the estuaries as well. Moving on to fresh water, so we finished the marine water. Now if you think about the fresh water, these fresh water are those which usually inhabit the freshwater ecosystem. See, they constitute so less of all the fresh water, that is 0.009%, and they generate only 3% of the net primary production, and freshwater ecosystems contains 41% of the world's known fish species. There are three types of freshwater ecosystems: those which do not flow or flow very, very slowly, more or less stagnant, they are called lentic ecosystems. Those which are actively flowing are called lotic, and those which are completely stagnant without any movement are called wetland. In comparison to lentic wetland, they absolutely have no movement, and of course they are dominated by vascular or higher plants, and they are also adapted to saturated soil, that is soil which is enriched or continuously wetted by water. It may be rainwater, it may be groundwater, it may be aquifers or anything of that sort. These are referred to as wetlands. Lentic ecosystem, like I told you, include the lake, which there is quite a bit of movement happening over there, but it is not flowing water as you would expect in the case of a river or a stream. It contains the shallow water zone, that is called the littoral zone, and the open water zone. The open water zone is called the photic zone. Whatever zone of the lake that you see near the shore is referred to as the littoral zone, and in the center of the lake, the open water zone is referred to as the photic zone. The aphotic or the profundal zone is the deeper part of the lake where there is no water, there is no sunlight over there, and the food web is entirely based on detritus, because whatever dead and decaying remains from the surface waters, they get settled towards the bottom of the lake. So the bottom of the lake, which receives very little sunlight or no sunlight at all, especially in deeper lakes, is referred to as the aphotic or the profundal zone. Lotic, like we saw, it consists of fast moving turbulent water. It has very, very high concentrations of dissolved oxygen in it. So remember, rivers and streams come under lotic habitats or lotic ecosystem under freshwater ecosystems. Wetlands, like I said, mostly contain stagnant water, water which has collected at a particular region. It is dominated by vascular plants. There are different types of wetlands. Swamps are basically consisting of standing water with woody trees over there. Marshes mostly contain shrubs, and it is mostly found near the shore of certain lakes and ponds. And fens and bogs are also different types. In fens actually you get water mostly from the groundwater sources, and in bogs it is mostly from external sources like rainwater. So both of fens and bogs are together referred to as a mire. And these wetlands are most productive natural ecosystems in the world because of the proximity of the water and the soil. The soil is permanently wetted by water, and there is also formation of partially degraded biomaterial, organic matter, which gets deposited underneath the water and above the soil, which is referred to as the peat. And this peat also holds a lot of nutrients and supports a lot of plants, and therefore it is considered to be the most productive natural ecosystem. Moving on to food chain, where one trophic level or one population is linked to another population. Now, on what basis is a food chain constructed? In a food chain, a particular organism is dependent upon the next organism, or a particular species in a link is dependent on the next organism in the link, or the organism which is behind it, before it, for its nutritional requirements. So based on that, for example, if I say frog and snake, now snake comes after frog. Now snake is dependent on frog for its nutritional requirement, for its energy source, because snake feeds on the frog. This is what a food chain is. A food chain tells us the direction in which the contained energy passes, isn't it? Like I said, frog and snake, energy passes from the frog to the snake because the snake feeds on the frog. The first idea of food chain was given way back in 9th century by Al-Jahiz, who was an African Arab scientist, and later it was popularized in early 20th century in 1927 by Charles Elton. In a food chain, all of you remember, there is a link. For example, a species A or a trophic level A is linked with B, B is linked with C, C is linked with D. So you know that B depends on A for its food requirement or nutritional requirement, C depends on B for its nutritional requirement, D depends on C for its nutritional requirement. So based on its nutritional requirement, you can see that the food chain is constructed, and there is always, now the solid arrows represents the energy flow. All of you remember, the energy flow cannot be in the reverse direction. The energy flow is always happening in the unidirectional. It is always unidirectional, and most, about 80 to 90%, now for example, much of the energy that is passing on from A to B is lost in the form of heat as per the second law of thermodynamics. So remember, only a very little amount of energy. If B feeds on A, it gets only a little bit of energy, because much of the energy, about 80 to 90% of the energy, is lost in the form of heat. Respiration cost. Now basically, not only heat. Now if I consume something, for example, if a snake consumes the frog, will it get all the energy that is stored in the flesh of the frog? No, much of it is lost in the respiratory cost. That is because much of it is used up by the respiration, excretion, digestion in the body of the snake itself, isn't it? And always, a food chain is something that progresses in a straight line. For our convenience, we consider it to be a straight line. There are limited number of levels in the food chain. Why there are limited number of levels in the food chain? Because I told you, at every step in the food chain, energy is lost to heat and energy is lost to respiration. So obviously there would not be enough energy for the final trophic levels. As a result, there is a very limited number of trophic levels in the food chain, because at a point of time, the energy becomes so diminished that it cannot sustain a group of species. It cannot sustain another trophic level. What are the different types of food chain? If it starts with a parasite, then it is referred to as a parasitic food chain. If it ends with a parasite, I'm sorry. So if it ends with a parasite, it is referred to as a parasitic food chain. You can take the simple example here. A large tree, there are a lot of birds. On the skin of birds, there are a lot of parasites. On the parasites, there are a lot of hyperparasites. Okay? Then if you talk about detritus food chain, in detritus food chain, it begins with a dead organic matter. The dead organic matter is referred to as detritus. Now the detritus is fragmented by earthworm. Earthworm is fed by the sparrow, and the sparrow is something which is eaten by the falcon. Similarly, you can say the detritus or the earthworm is also fed by, is eaten by the frog, and the frog is eaten by the snake, and the snake is eaten by the peacock. So ecosystems of this type, that is detritus ecosystem, they are not dependent on direct solar energy. They depend on supply of organic matter. Since it starts from detritus, they depend on the supply of organic matter from the detritus. And also, please remember, mostly these detritus food chains are seen in those areas where there's plenty of nutrients or organic matter in the form of detritus, or the dead and decaying organic matter that is seen in the soil. We have already discussed about the steps involved in detritus feeding and decomposition, like fragmentation, leaching, catabolism, and then partial degradation or humification, and complete degradation or mineralization. Then if you have detritus rich in chitin and lignin, they undergo slow decomposition. If they contain nitrogen and water, the process of decomposition happening in the detritus by decomposing microbes is very, very quick. And then we have, if you have aerobic conditions, then the process of decomposition also happens at a very faster rate. Primary consumers are detritivores, including bacteria. So most of the detritivores which feed on the detritus are referred to as the primary consumers, and they include bacteria, protozoans, and fungi. And detritivores are in turn, these detritivores which are primary consumers are later fed by secondary consumers. Say for example, you have a earthworm that acts as a secondary consumer, nematodes and insect larvae, etc. And these food chains are generally very shorter in comparison to the grazing food chain that we will be discussing in a shorter while. However, one must remember that the detritus food chain is completely indispensable. It is very, very necessary in an ecosystem, because imagine if not for the detritus feeders, if all the organic nutrients would have remained locked in the dead bodies and dead remains of plants and animals, it wouldn't be cycled back into the ecosystem. So it is very, very important, because the detritus converts the decaying organic matter into inorganic substances, which is released back into the ecosystem, into the trophic system, into the trophic levels. The most common type of food chain that you see is nothing but the grazing food chain, and this is also referred to as the predator food chain. The very common food chain that you see in land ecosystem is referred to as the grazing food chain. Of course, it is seen in aquatic ecosystem also. It is very easy to remember. Instead of detritus, you are starting, think of grazing as something which involves green plants, like how a cow feeds on a grass. So think of something that is green. So it is something that starts off with a primary producer, which has chloroplast. It may be a grass on land, it may be phytoplankton in case of aquatic systems. In grazing, in aquatic systems, grazing food chain is a major channel, a conduit or major channel for energy flow. So you can think of a simple, I told you, whenever you think of grazing food chain, think of a cow grazing on a grass. It involves a green plant like grass in land, as well as like a phytoplankton in water. Think of energy being provided by the sun, and then you have producers. A grass is being eaten by the grasshopper. The grasshopper is eaten by the shrew, and the owl eats the shrew. So this is a very simplified form of grazing food chain for you. And then we had already discussed about the different trophic levels in the food chain. We have the base of the food chain, that is the primary producers, and the primary consumers feed on the primary producers, secondary consumers feed on the primary consumers, and the top carnivore or tertiary consumers feed on the secondary consumers. Please go through some of the simple examples. You will get an idea of how a food chain of a grazing food chain is organized. If you think of a water, like I told you, on land it is grass, which is the green plant, which is having chloroplast in it, which can fix the solar energy. In water, you obviously have the microscopic plants, which are referred to as phytoplankton. So these two sequences are simple examples for a common food chain that is seen in water. This is also a grazing food chain. Remember, as long as it starts with a primary producer, like a green plant, like phytoplankton or a grass, it is referred to as a grazing food chain. See how here it ends with a crocodile, and here it ends with a bird like a kingfisher or a stork. Then we have a food web. Now, if many food chains get interconnected to each other depending on their feeding connections, then we get a web of food chains, which is referred to as a food web. You can see how all the food chains are interconnected to each other, and these interconnected food chains are referred to as a food web. Energy flow in an ecosystem, we have always been telling that in a food chain along the trophic level, energy always flows in the forward direction. It can always be from the sunlight onwards, from the producers onwards, because these are the first ones to capture the radiant energy and store it in the form of, or to use that energy in order to make the biomass or the organic matter. So it always starts from the producers and progresses onwards. It cannot be in the reverse direction. Energy cannot pass in the reverse direction, and always the passage of energy is based on the 10% law that was proposed by Raymond Lindemann in 1942, that every trophic level receives only 10% of the energy that is captured by the previous trophic level. Okay, here you can see how the sunlight had so much of energy, but only 10% of it, say 20,000 kilocal per meter square per year, is captured in the primary producers. However, if you see the rate of flesh formation or the rate of organic matter that is formed, or the amount of organic matter that is formed in the primary consumers, is only 10% of 20,000, that is 2,000. And then it is the rate of formation in secondary consumers is only 20,000. That means the energy that they derive and the energy that they store in the form of organic matter at each trophic level is only 10% of the previous trophic level. Plants had stored the energy in the form of biomass at the rate of 20,000, but animals are storing the biomass biomass at the rate of 2000. Why out of 20,000, where did the 80,000 go? That 18,000 went away in heat, it went away in life processes of both the producers as well as the life processes of consumers like digestion, excretion, respiration, etc. Finally, the consumers could only store 2000 kilocal of that energy in the form of flesh and fat in their body. So this is called the 10% law. Moving on to Eltonian pyramids, the ecological pyramids is a graphical representation, is a diagrammatical representation of the animals which are occupying or the organisms which are occupying the different trophic level in the form of pyramids. And these Eltonian pyramids, they are called as Eltonian pyramids because these were developed for the first time by Charles Elton in 1927. You can see the pyramid of number. The number increases as you go down the pyramid, or if you go up the pyramid, the number decreases. The number of species or the number of organisms that occupy each trophic level, when it is represented in the pyramidal form, it represents the pyramid of number. Pyramid of number, as you can see, is upright in this case. There are certain cases, like if you think of a tree ecosystem, the pyramid of number can become inverted. Like we had seen, there is one tree, there are many birds, there are many, many parasites, there are many, many hyperparasites. So if you think of a single tree ecosystem, then the pyramid of number can be inverted. But in this case, the pyramid is an upright pyramid. If you think of pyramid of biomass, you are taking into account the dry weight or the organic matter or the biomass that is stored in them per unit area, per unit time. It may be in terms of kg per meter square over here. So they have not taken the time into consideration. I had told you, when you do not affix the criteria of time, it is simply called as primary production. So how much they produce per unit area is taken into consideration. Notice how the producers have the highest biomass in comparison to the topmost carnivores or the tertiary carnivores in that particular trophic level. So please remember, each trophic level here is represented in terms of how much organic matter or biomass they store in terms of kg per meter square. Since there is no unit of time over here, it is considered to be primary production, that is amount of organic matter or biomass produced per unit area in terms of kg per meter square. Okay. When can the pyramid of biomass be inverted? In terms of sea, in aquatic ecosystem, like in marine ecosystem or sea, you can see how the primary producers have a very low biomass, because please remember, primary producers are phytoplankton, which are very, very tiny and microscopic. Obviously, if you consider their biomass, their numbers are huge, but if you consider their biomass, it will be lesser than the fish, because fishes have a larger body in compared to the tiny microscopic phytoplankton. Because you are taking into account biomass, and because these primary producers of phytoplankton are very, very tiny and their biomass is very less in comparison to fishes that occupy that second trophic level, say for example you have the primary consumers which are the fishes, because the biomass of the fishes is greater than the biomass of the tiny phytoplankton which fix the solar energy, in terms of aquatic ecosystem or the sea, the biomass becomes inverted. Pyramid of energy can never be inverted, please all of you remember, because the energy flow, as we've been learning, it is always from the sunlight and from the primary producers onwards. And notice how the energy is following the 10% law, that is, the sunlight had 10 lakh joules of energy, but only 10,000 joules of energy is stored in the primary producers. And notice how 10% of which is carried on to the next trophic level, that is the primary consumer, store in the form of flesh only 1000 joules, which is 10% of the 10,000 joules that they probably obtained by feeding on the plants. Then we have to learn certain mathematical equations. If you compare the energy converted into biomass to the energy that is converted or that is present in the biomass of a particular trophic level, if you calculate the percentage, you get something called the ecological efficiency. Then if you convert or if you compare the gross primary production that is happening with the amount of sunlight that was available by the green plants, then you get something that is referred to as, remember, gross means you are not taking into account the respiratory losses. How much sunlight was available to them and how much were they capable of making biomass using that sunlight is referred to as the photosynthetic efficiency. Another comparison is the net primary productivity, taking into account the respiratory losses and the gross primary production. productivity, that is how much of it has been lost, how much percentage of it has been lost as respiratory loss, is nothing but referred to as the net production efficiency. So it is important for you to learn these formulae. Then if you see comparison between the food energy that is assimilated meaning how much of the food energy has been, now if I am eating my food, how much is the food energy that I actually ate and how much of the food energy I used up for my digestion, for my excretion, for my life processes, that is referred to as assimilation efficiency. So what food energy you actually consumed to what food energy was used up in the life processes is referred to as assimilation efficiency. Then we have ecological succession. We have in a particular piece of land, in a particular site, you have varied series of biotic communities that keep changing, and ultimately there is no change, that is referred to as the climax community. Always remember, the first biotic community which occupies a particular patch of land is called as the pioneer community. If it is a land which has for the first time developed a particular community, then it is referred to as a primary succession. It takes thousands of years to happen. Remember, there was no life before. For the first time on a patch of land, life is becoming established, communities are becoming established, then it is referred to as primary succession. If, for example, life existed on a patch of land and for some reason, like the reasons mentioned over here, life got eliminated, it got exterminated, and then again new life is being established over several years, then it is referred to as secondary succession. The early colonizers of the secondary succession, like I told you, in secondary succession, life existed once, but then it got exterminated due to some natural calamity. And then only another group of colonizer called fugitive species, they start occupying or they start establishing themselves in a secondary succession, which takes about 50 to 100 years in a grassland and 100 to 200 years in the development of a forest. What are the stages? First, there is formation of, in any succession, there is formation of a bare substrate, which is a possible site where these species can land upon and they can establish a community. Formation of a bare site is referred to as nudation. Then the propagules or the organisms start migrating over there, they start colonizing there, they start germinating, they start establishing themselves over that site called ecesis, and then they start increasing in their number, they start competing with each other for the resources, and they start modifying to their environment, and they start making adjustments to accommodate new colonists. This is called reaction. And finally, the community attains a so-called stability, that is referred to as the climax community. If this kind of a succession, that is of changes in the biological or biotic communities, if it is happening on land, then it is referred to as a lithosphere or a xerosphere. It starts off with lichens, because lichens are the ones which are capable of growing on a bare rock, and they are the ones which release acids like lichenic acids, which dissolve the rock particles, which start the weathering process required for soil formation in this case. And then you have moss, which take up later, some of the hardy mosses which grow after a certain degree of fragmentation has happened. And then annual grasses take their place. And then finally grasses which grow for an entire year called perennial grasses take their place. And finally you have plants which are woody and shrubs which develop over there. And ultimately you have a forest ecosystem that is called a climax community. See how initially the mosses, lichens came, and then came the mosses, and then the grasses came, annual grasses, perennial grasses, and then shrubs, and finally you have the forest ecosystem with woody plants that make up the climax community. So what was a bare rock has become converted into a forest ecosystem. This is something that started with a bare rock, that's why it is referred to as a lithosphere. It is a land ecosystem, a bare rock being a land which has dry condition, not moist or water condition, that's why this is referred to as a lithosphere or a xerosphere. What if the starting stage is a pool of water, like we started off with a bare rock in the previous example? What if we start with a pool of water? Then it is referred to as a hydrosphere. Even in hydrosphere, we end up with a forest ecosystem. Always remember, the tendency is from either dry to moist, either dry conditions or wet conditions to moderate conditions. Like forest is moderate, it is not neither too dry nor too wet, it is moist condition. So always the tendency of ecological succession is from too dry to too wet to moderate dry and moderate moist, moderate wet or moist conditions. So in plankton stage, you have the water bodies which are occupied by phytoplankton. Probably their spores and their reproductive propagules are carried by wind and animals to the water body. They multiply very rapidly, and some of the zooplanktons also develop, which start feeding on the plankton, and their dead bodies settle to the bottom. Death and decomposition results in the formation of organic matter. Then you have submerged plants which start emerging, and after that you have floating plants which emerge, and then you have amphibious plants which start growing, being anchored to the bottom of the pond or at the edges of the pond, but much of their body is exposed above water. They are called reed and swamp stage. And then we have sedges and marsh meadow stage, which are basically found in the shore regions of the water body. And finally you have the woodland stage, where woodish plants start developing. So you have to see that the shrubs shade away the plants of the sedge meadow. So you basically have the shrubs that are formed, and then finally you have the woody plants which take the place of these shrubs, and ultimately a forest is formed. So you have to remember some of the forests, like rainforest in moist tropical areas, and coniferous and deciduous forests are also formed ultimately. So we started off with a water body and see how initially we had phytoplankton, and then we had submerged plants, then we had floating plants, then we had these amphibious plants like reed swamp, and then we had marsh meadow shrubs, and then we had woody plants which make up the forest ecosystem. Ultimately a water condition is getting converted into a forest condition. So extremely wet conditions are getting converted to moderate dry or moderate wet conditions, and this is referred to as hydrosia. Because it starts off with water or extremely wet condition, it is referred to as a hydrosia. When we think of nutrient cycles, we have to think of some of the essential elements, and where is all the nutrients stored? All the nutrients are stored in the soil, and the sum total of all the nutrients that is stored at a given point of time in the soil is referred to as the standing state. And there is a reservoir pool, like for example, if you think of minerals like phosphates, it is stored in rocks. And there is a cyclic pool where constantly the nutrients are let out for plants and animals to use them. So wherever they are being constantly emptied, they are called as cycling pool, and wherever they are being stored, it is called the reservoir pool. If you see the carbon cycle, you know how carbon dioxide, the pool here, the reservoir as well as the cyclic pool, is the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, carbon dioxide in the sediments, in minerals like limestone and dolomite, and in sediments like calcareous deposits in the sea. And carbon dioxide sinks also can be carbon dioxide in water. How animals and plants make use of, like here you can see, by combustion carbon dioxide is being sent into its sink, which is nothing but the carbon dioxide in its atmosphere, isn't it? So atmosphere is like the reservoir pool. If you burn down forests and fossil fuels, also you are letting out carbon dioxide to the reservoir, that is carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. And from the atmosphere, from the reservoir pool, you take the carbon dioxide, is taken up by the green plants in order to fix the carbon dioxide. So we can consider the green plants as the sink here, because they are storing the carbon dioxide in the form of organic matter. And also you can see carbon dioxide is given out by respiration and decomposition. It goes back into the reservoir, which is nothing but the carbon dioxide in atmosphere. And from atmosphere, from the reservoir, carbon dioxide is cycled in to dissolve in the water, and that is again sinked, or it is stored in the photosynthetic forms, or it is sinked in the calcium carbonate shells of these mollusks, which again can be sent back into a second reservoir like calcareous sediments when these animals die and their bodies get decomposed, and the carbon is sent back into the calcareous sediments. And finally from the sediments you can see carbon gets locked up in the form of limestone and dolomite, and over the years the dead and decaying organic matter that gets compressed in the earth's crust, that gets stored in the sink, which gets converted into fossil fuels like oil and gas, whose benefits we reap by harnessing them, by harvesting them from the earth's crust. So you can basically see a source and a sink. A source is mostly a reservoir, and a sink is where it is extracted from the reservoir and it is stored temporarily or permanently. Mostly, if you think about limestone and dolomite, which is present in the earth's crust, it may be a permanent sink, but of course a sink is also a reservoir, as well as it is a cycling pool, because constantly carbon dioxide is removed from the sink and it is sent into other group of organisms. So it is a cyclic pool basically. Both the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and the carbon dioxide stored in the earth's crust can be considered to be a cycling pool, because the constant carbon dioxide movement keeps taking through and fro. Isn't it? To and fro, it keeps happening. It's not like carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is completely trapped in the atmosphere forever. It is used up. So carbon dioxide in the limestone deposits is completely trapped over there. No, leaching does happen into the soil. So basically, it is the cycling pool. If you think of phosphorus cycle, producers make use of phosphorus in the soil solution. How does phosphorus reach the soil? From rock minerals. Again, rock minerals are a cyclic pool. It's not like phosphorus is completely trapped in them forever. They reach the soil by weathering, and then the soil gives away the phosphorus to the producers. From the producers, the phosphorus reaches consumers. The consumers die and they form the detritus, and the producers also die and they form the detritus. From the detritus, the phosphorus is sent back to the soil by the process of decomposition. And in decomposition, you can see phosphorus being sent back into the soil solution. Of course, from the soil solution, you have the phosphorus that runs off. It may or may not reach back the sediment, so it may or may not go back to the rock minerals that is basically there in the earth's crust. So again, the rock minerals constantly give out these substances into the soil solution, so you can consider this to be a reservoir as well as a cycling pool, because it is letting out the phosphorus into the soil solution. Okay. Ecosystem services, some of the things which we should be thankful for our ecosystem. We should be thankful that our ecosystem carries carbon fixation. Oxygen is released by microorganisms and green plants thanks to photosynthesis. Animals and insects and varied other higher organisms like animals, higher animals also carry out pollination, because of which we are able to fill our stomach today. So we should be thankful for their services of pollination. We should be thankful to the services of animal species which carry out seed dispersal. We should be thankful for all the species which work together to bring about optimal use of resources. We should be thankful to farmlands, aquaculture, orchards, aquariums, and agricultural practices. Agriculture is made possible because of the natural resources that the natural diversity that the wild population of plants offers to us, and the soil which is offered by nature to us. All of these provide us with artificial ecosystems for study and, of course, to fill our stomach to procure our food. So these services which we must be thankful for, which we cannot attach a price tag to, are referred to as ecosystem services. Please remember, this is something which you cannot attach a price tag to. We had learnt a similar concept in biodiversity, why we should conserve biodiversity, a broadly utilitarian aspect. Okay, so with this we complete the synopsis part of the chapter ecosystem. Thank you.